Here is a script for an R web scraper that extracts data from static and dynamic websites. With slight adjustments, this scraper could be used for a variety of websites. In this guide, I'll show you how to set up your own web scraper using R along with its most prominent data extraction libraries. Hello, I'm Augustus, and in this video you'll find out how to install R and RStudio along with the required packages, send GET requests, parse the acquired data, extract images, deal with dynamic websites, save data to a data frame, and export data frame to a CSV file. So, let's get started. First, to prepare the development environment, you'll require two things, R and RStudio. For R itself, installing the base distribution is enough. Then, install RStudio. The free version, RStudio Desktop, is enough. Feel free to use package managers such as apt, homebrew, and chocolatey. Once set up, launch RStudio, navigate to the packages section, and install the rvest library to scrape static pages. Dplyr to enable the usage of the pipe operator, HTTR to handle timeouts, JSONLite to parse JSON format, and RSelenium to scrape dynamic websites. Now, enter the package names separated by a comma and click install. Alternatively, you can run the install packages command in the console. The most popular package for web scraping in R is rvest. It provides functions to access public websites and query specific elements using CSS selectors and XPath. Let's start by sending an HTTP GET request to the target webpage. In this case, a list of ISO country codes. Load rvest by entering library rvest in the source area. Commands entered here can be executed by selecting the desired line and clicking run in the top right. To send an HTTP GET request to the URL and retrieve the webpage, use the read.html function. This function requires one mandatory argument, a path or a URL. Note that it can also read an HTML string. The function returns an object of the HTML document type containing the desired public data. A side note, if you want to use a proxy, run this line, specifying the proxy server address and port. Find out how to choose the most suitable proxies for a task at hand by following the links in the video description below. Now, run the code. First, select the code and then press Ctrl-Enter or Command-Enter. Note that the read.html function does not provide any way to control timeouts. To handle timeout errors, use the HTTR library and its GET function along with try-catch. Alternatively, you can also use the session object from rvest. rvest provides a convenient way to select HTML elements using CSS selectors and XPath. Select elements using the HTML elements function. Note the plural variation of this function, which returns a list of matching elements. There is also a singular variation that returns only the first matching HTML element. If the selector type isn't specified, it is assumed to be a CSS selector. For example, our target page contains data in a table. The HTML markup of the table is this line. The only class needed to create a unique selector is the sortable class. In this case, the CSS selector is table sortable. The function stores the resulting HTML element in an lm variable. Now, let's see how to get HTML attributes. The HTML function makes it easy to use the rvest select class. If you want to use an element with the class heading, use this line of code. Another use case is the rvest's div class. You may come across a way to select HTML with the HTML node function. However, this method is now obsolete. Instead, you should use the HTML element and HTML elements functions. both in plural and singular forms. For example, you can extract text from an element by calling the HTML text function. Alternatively, when looking for an attribute, you can use the HTML attribute function. Let's extract the src attribute of an element. For content in HTML table format, you can use the rvest's read table function. This function makes an HTML that contains table elements and returns a data frame. But what about dynamic pages, you might ask? Well, there are two approaches. First is to use RSelenium, the dedicated library for scraping dynamic pages. The second is to employ RVEST to find a hidden API that contains target data. For now, let's continue with the second option, the RVEST approach. Quotes2scrape.com is a website with an infinite scroll, therefore it's a dynamic web page using JavaScript. Navigate to this website, open the developer tools, and go to the network tab. Scroll down to load more content and watch the network traffic. You'll notice that every time a new set of quotes is loaded, a call to a specific URL is sent, and the page number keeps on increasing. Notice that the response is returned in JSON. Keeping that in mind, you can build a simple RVEST JSON parser. First, look through the page and search for the p tag containing JSON data in text format. Let's use the JSONLite library to parse JSON text into a native R object utilizing the fromJSON method. Use a loop to parse JavaScript for a page with infinite scroll. In this example, the loop is running 10 times. You can modify this code according to your specific requirements. Data frames are fundamental data storage structures in R. They resemble matrices, but feature some critical differences. Data frames are tightly coupled collections of variables where each column can be of a different data type. To convert the data stored in HTML element, use the HTML table function. Notice that the variable df is a data frame. Also, note the use of an optional parameter header equals false. The HTML table function can also extract column names from the HTML table. If you set the header to true, it will automatically create column names in the data frame. Since the columns will be created manually, let's set it to false. This parameter is only required in certain scenarios. In most cases, the default value of true should work. For the wiki table, the header spawns two rows. The first row can be discarded, making it a three-step process. The first step is disabling the automatic assignment of headers, which is already done. The next step is setting the column names with the second row. The third step is deleting the first two rows from the body of the data frame. The data frame is now ready for further analysis. Finally, the last step of the data extraction process is saving the acquired data frame to a CSV file. To export the data frame, use the writeCSV function. This function takes two parameters, the data frame instance and the name of the CSV file. The function will export the data frame to a file named isocodes.csv in your current directory. And that's it. You are now equipped with the knowledge of extracting text-based HTML content using RVEST. Further on, let's see how to extract visual content such as images. Image download involves three steps: downloading a page, extracting the image URL by locating an element that contains it, and getting the image itself. Let's download the first image from the Wikipedia page of the Eiffel Tower. Start by downloading the page using the read.html function and locate the image tag containing the image. To locate the image, use the thumb border CSS selector. The following step is to get the URL of the image embedded in the CRC attribute. Use the rvest's HTML function to do so. The image URL is relative. let's convert it to an absolute URL using one of the rvest functions, URL absolute. To wrap up the process, use rvest's download function to download the file. As mentioned before, there are two approaches to dealing with dynamic pages. Let's see how to do it with the first approach using RSelenium, a dedicated browser-based rendering solution for dynamic pages. Selenium is a popular browser-based rendering solution that can be used with R. Among the many great features of Selenium are taking screenshots, scrolling pages, clicking on specific links or parts of the page, and inputting any keyboard stroke onto any part of a web page. It's the most versatile when combined with classic web scraping techniques. There are two ways to start a Selenium server and get a client driver instance. The first is to use RSelenium only, while the second is to start the Selenium server using Docker and then connect to it using RSelenium. Let's delve deeper into how the first method works. RSelenium allows you to set up a Selenium server and browser. Doing so will download the required binaries, start the server, and return an instance of the Selenium driver. Alternatively, you can use Docker to run the Selenium server and connect to this instance. Install Docker and run a command from the terminal to download the latest Firefox image and start a container. Apart from Firefox, Chrome and PhantomJS can also be used. Once the server is started, use RStudio to connect to the server and get an instance of the driver. These commands will connect to Firefox running in the Docker container and return an instance of the remote driver. If something isn't working, examine both the Docker logs and RSelenium error messages. Note that after visiting a website and before moving on to the parsing functions, it might be essential to let a considerable amount of time pass. There's a possibility that data won't be loaded yet and the entire parsing algorithm will crash. Specific functions could be employed to wait for particular HTML elements to load fully. First, navigate to the desired page. In this case, let's scrape the name, prices, and stock availability of all books in the science fiction genre. The target is a dummy bookstore for web scraping practice. To navigate to this URL, use the navigate function. To locate the HTML elements, use the find elements function. This function is flexible and can work with CSS selectors, XPath, or even with specific attributes, such as an ID name, name tag, and others. For this example, let's use XPath. The book titles are hidden in the alt attribute of the image thumbnail. The XPath for these image tags will be like this. To extract the value of the alt attribute, use the getElementAttribute function. However, in this particular case, there is a list of elements. To extract the attribute from all elements of the list, apply a custom function using the supply function of R. Note that this function will return the attribute value of a list. Use this attribute to extract only the first value. Moving on to price data extraction, the following is an HTML markup of the HTML element containing the price. The XPath to select price is this. This time, use the getElementText function to get the text from the HTML element. Lastly, extract stock availability. At last, let's create a data frame. At this point, there are three variables. Every variable is a list that contains a required data point. Data points can be used to create a data frame. Once the data frame is created, you can use it for further analysis. Moreover, the data frame can be easily exported to a CSV file with a single line. The code is now complete. You can find it in our GitHub by following the links in the video description below. Web scraping with R is a relatively uncomplicated and straightforward process if you are already familiar with the intricacies of R. For most static web pages, the rvest library provides enough functionality. If any kind of dynamic elements come into play, a typical HTML extraction won't be up to the task. If so, more often than not, RSelenium is the right solution to alleviate a more complicated load. If you have any questions about building a web scraper with R or any other programming language, feel free to contact us at hello@oxylabs.io or simply leave a comment below. To see more content like this, hit the subscribe button as well as like and share this video on your social media. Thank you for tuning in, this was Oxylabs, and I hope to see you next time.